Our next guest, Andres Thomas Contreras, has been in the embassy with Zelaya for many months and is the last remaining journalist on site. We've been able to speak with Andres throughout his journey there, and he's joining us today as an end appears to be nigh. But what is it? Andres, welcome to the program.
It's good to be with you, Laura.
Now, Manuel Zelaya has said he would not simply go home, at least not until the end of his term. At the end of January, is that his plan now at this point?
His plan is to try to leave the embassy as soon as possible. However, the coup regime is not giving him permission to leave. What's happening is that initially they insisted that he resign as president in order to leave. Then they took away that condition, but they have maintained the condition of requiring him to seek political asylum. And he, as president of this country, doesn't believe he needs political asylum. And so he is refusing to do that. And so it's still up in the air as to whether he will actually be allowed to leave the embassy before the end of January.
Now, why did the Congress decide as they did there in Honduras, do you think, Andres?
The Congress made two decisions. One, of course, was what you just referred to in terms of the election. They did agree that it was a free and fair election. However, independent analysts have clearly showed that the abstention rate was exceedingly high. It was President Zelaya says it was over 60%. The other decision that the Congress took had to do with ratifying the coup that they themselves initially authorized at the very end of June. So this ratification is a way of covering themselves in terms of not being prosecuted later for having voted for the coup, but also it is a way of punishing President Zelaya himself, who has sought to continuously ostracize Honduras and the coup regime since the coup itself.
Now, Honduran immigrants here in the U.S. seem to be kind of divided in their opinion. Here's a very quick report, and then I want to ask you about the role of the U.S. Congress. Less divided, it seems. Take a look.
Quitar al presidente su silla, ¿cómo se llama
eso? Eso se llama sustitución.
Golpe de Estado.
Eso no es golpe de Estado. Yo soy liberal. Yo trabajé por él. Fui a las elecciones y estuve en mesas electorales. Trabajé por él, voté por él. Pero ahora no le doy mi voto porque yo aquí me gano la vida trabajando para poderle dar de comer a mis hijos en Honduras. Y él no es quien para venirme a quitar a mí lo que yo le voy a dar a mis hijos.
Now, that was Honduran immigrant opinion right after the coup. From what we can see, not a whole lot has changed in the response to the elections of this season. What about the U.S. Congress's role in all that? Divided? What?
The U.S. Congress has been divided. Clearly, the role of Senator DeMint from South Carolina was very, very much of an obstacle in terms of moving forward in Honduras. What he did was demand that the U.S. accept the results of the election, whether President Zelaya would have been restored or not. And he held hostage the confirmation of both the Assistant Secretary of State for Western Hemisphere, as well as the ambassadorship to Brazil. And so when finally Hillary Clinton and the Obama administration agreed to accept the election results, whether or not President Zelaya was in office, then Senator DeMint had his way and he let those obstacles go. Others in the Congress have played a positive role. Senator Kerry has been voicing policy even against Obama in terms of not going far enough to pressure the coup leaders to leave power. So there has been division in the U.S. Congress, but it appears most of the U.S. Congress accepts the election, and this is something that is very questionable because, as I said, the abstention rates were so high that President asked for the elections to be annulled.
Talk a bit about public opinion in Honduras. I'm also curious what Hondurans can expect and do expect from President-elect Porfirio Lobo.
Public opinion in Honduras, clearly there are many who support Porfirio Lobo, but many see him as a wealthy businessman. He previously was the president of the Congress some years ago, but basically they don't see him bringing the change that they were hoping would come with the end of the term of President Zelaya. The trigger that set off the coup itself had to do with the Constituent Assembly that many people in Honduras are requesting. That Constituent Assembly would change the Constitution and take it from the elite and the powerful in the country to a document that really represents the interests of the vast majority. So Porfirio Lobo is yet another one who is not moving forward to try to bring a constituent assembly and therefore respond to the needs of the people.
But more broadly, Andres, you've talked a lot on this program in the past month about the popular movements engaged around this coup and people's both hopes that they would be triumphant, signal something to the region, and their fears that if indeed the coup was enforced, it could bring the trend of change to a stop, not just in Honduras, but in the region, in face not only of what seems to have happened on the electoral front, but also on the election front, with the sorts of reports you've brought and others have brought about what looks like very corrupt election practices on Election Day. What are those social movement leaders saying about where they go next and their hopes in this context?
The social movement leaders, first of all, were the ones to very much point out the violence that took place the day before the election and on the election itself. In San Pedro Sula, there was a peaceful demonstration that was brutally repressed. And people were arrested and hospitalized as a result of that repression. The social movement leaders are continuing now to move forward to look at, one, the incredible abstinence in the election as a victory for the resistance itself, and two, channeling that then to energy toward the Constituent Assembly, which in fact could draw up a new constitution and then again respond to the needs of the people and the women.
Andres, well, thank you so much for joining us, even on that shaky line there. Andres Contreras in Honduras. We'll stay in touch with you.